This video is going to be a short proof of the nested compact set property. Just think this is a fun exercise to do as we wrap up our study of compact sets. So what it says is that if we have a nested family of compact sets, then their intersection is non-empty. There's a point that they all have in common. Before I prove this, let me give you three examples of nested sets, and we will see which example satisfies the hypotheses of this theorem. Okay, so example number one, consider open intervals of the form 0 to 1 over n. So what I mean here is the first one is 0 to 1, then 0 to 1/2, 0 to 1/3. These are nested. Similarly, consider closed intervals of the form n to infinity. So 1 to infinity, 2 to infinity, 3 to infinity, 4 to infinity. These are also nested. And then consider 0 to 1 over n, where the difference between this and the first example is that I am looking at closed intervals instead of open intervals. Okay, for each one, we want to take the intersection across the natural numbers. Take a moment, if you don't see it yet, to pause and work out what the intersection for each of these families should look like. Okay, for this first example, we have a nested family of open sets. Nothing to the left of 0 will be in this intersection. 0 is also not in the intersection because it's not in any of these. We have a parentheses here, if you will. And if you look at positive numbers, for any positive number, we can choose a denominator here large enough that that positive number sits to the right. So it's like eventually we can kind of cut away every positive number. And that means that this intersection is empty. Nothing survives as n goes to infinity. Here, this is a nested family of closed sets, and each one is infinite in length. So we have 1 to infinity, 2 to infinity, 3 to infinity. Same idea, though, that for any positive number, eventually where we start future sets will be to the right. So every positive number is going to get removed eventually when n is large enough. So no number lives in every single one of these sets. On the other hand, if we look at this family, notice 0 belongs to every single one of them. In fact, it's the only point that will survive this intersection. So this intersection is non-empty. This is just an illustration of this theorem. So here we have bounded sets, which are not closed. Here we have closed sets, which are not bounded. And here we have sets which are closed and bounded. Because we're working on the real number line, that's equivalent to being compact. So this is a nested family of compact sets, and their intersection has a point in it. So their intersection is non-empty. Looking at this theorem, it's not required that these sets are like kind of strictly included. So I might use this kind of soup set notation here, but I don't mean that every set is a proper subset. So maybe F2 is the same as F3, and maybe they aren't shrinking quite as much as this example, but that doesn't matter. What we're saying is if you have any family of compact sets, so that the first one, F1, contains all the future members, F2 contains all the future members, F3 contains all the future members, they all have a point in common. Their intersection is non-empty. All right, what we are going to do is prove this using the fact that we know that in any metric space, being compact is equivalent to being sequentially compact. So that's the condition I'm going to use. That means that I am going to build up a sequence in this like family of sets. Let me take a moment to step aside. I will erase this. If you would like, start trying to imagine how you might construct a useful sequence to work with. All right, I'm going to design a sequence. It's going to be a very basic construction. I'll put the sequence description here and then we'll finish the proof over there. So proof. Design a sequence as follows. Choose the first member of the sequence to live in F1. That's it. Choose the second member. Maybe I should say choose. Choose the second member in F2. Choose the third member in F3. And keep going in that way. What's key to recognize here is that F2 is a subset of F1. So X2, being in F2, also places it in F1. And similarly, X3 has been chosen in F3, which means it's also in F2 and it's also in F1. Okay. We've now created our sequence. Let's move on. Notice I'll use curly bracket here to denote my sequence. Notice this sequence lives in F1. Since F1 is sequentially compact, because it's compact, so maybe I should say that, since F1 is compact, it's sequentially compact. And therefore, this sequence has a subsequence which converges to a limit which also lives in F1. What I'm going to do is very shorthand. I'll say there exists a subsequence. So hear me, there exists a subsequence of this sequence which converges to a limit in F1. Okay. So since F1 is compact, it's sequentially compact, and therefore this sequence yields a subsequence which converges to a limit which also lives in F1. This limit here is what I claim will live in the intersection. So it's the reason why this is not going to be empty. There may be other things that survive the intersecting process, but this definitely will. That's what we have to show. We need to show that this limit actually lives in all of this family. It's not too bad. Let me actually write out a demonstration for what this subsequence could look like. So this is a bit of an aside. I'm just trying to illustrate this proof. Suppose that this subsequence, it is an infinite sequence in its own right, but its members consist of members from this sequence preserving the order. So you extract a sequence from this sequence, but you can't rearrange terms. What that means is such a subsequence could look like x1, x3, x10, x11, x20, x3000, x3005, etc. Okay, just want to write this out so that it helps see the rest of the argument. So it's terms from this sequence preserving the order. So this is the first term of the sequence. This is the third one. Nobody switches places. Notice that everything from the second entry on lives in F2. This might not, but if I kick this first entry out of the subsequence and look at this subsequence, this is now a subsequence in its own right. It's still an infinite list formed from terms from this sequence preserving the order, and every term in here lives in F2. And then if I say, okay, forget the first finite two terms, look at the infinite sequence beginning in the third entry, all of these terms must live in F3. So by removing just a finite number of terms as needed from this subsequence, we produce subsequences in like any of the other sets we'd like to. So let me write that down. For any natural number n, let's make it capital N. For any index capital N, notice that the subsequence, starting with indices at least as large as capital N, because x sub capital N is in F sub capital N, as are all future terms. This is a subset of F sub capital N. But if this sequence converges to x naught, so does this sequence. Any subsequence of a convergent sequence converges to the same limit. Since x sub n sub k, starting with the capital nth term or larger, converges to x naught, There are different ways that you could now argue that this is in the compact set F sub capital N. What I will say is that if you are the limit of a convergent sequence, which lives in a closed set, you belong to the closure. That was a theorem that we've proven in the past. So this limit is an element of the closure of F sub capital N, but that's a compact set, so it's closed. Therefore, this limit belongs to F sub capital N for all natural numbers. Therefore, this point is in the intersection, and that's it. Thus, all right, I think this is a very fun proof. We pass from compactness to sequential compactness. We build up a sequence. I think the observations along the way are fun. So kind of recognizing that as we make the sequence, each term lives in all the previous compact sets, kind of looking at this behavior of the subsequence. So I hope you enjoyed this proof as well. Thank you for your attention.